let's kind of reiterate what we're talking about here. So some universities' academic integrity policy disallows cheating, as I would assume they all do. This includes copying homework with or without permission. A class has students perform their homework, submit things on a shared system similar to general.asu.edu. Student A forgets to read protect their homework file, and student B copies the file. So who did something wrong? Why is student B even able to see student A's work? Somebody tell you
something? Yeah, I know it's a shared server, but shouldn't it also have, like, users going and see their own stuff?
So how can you do this? Anybody play on a shared server before?
Pretty sure you can see everybody's stuff on general, can't you?
What was that?
Doesn't everybody just have a folder on general?
Right.
You can actually just CD up into the home directory and CD back down to somebody else's.
Yep, so you can, depending on how the server is configured, the users probably have a home directory and /home, and then the username. And then within there, it's you as a user, you own your home directory, so you can actually modify the permissions to be whatever you want. Right, so which would be a case where maybe you would want the students to be able to share things?
Collaboration.
What was that?
A group project.
Yeah, you may have students working together, right? So they may decide, okay, let's all work out of one person's group folder, and then in that case, you want them to actually be able to. So if you didn't allow them ways to work together and to share things, then you kind of defeated the purpose there. So who's in the wrong? So what is, well, let's start at the beginning. So the policy means what? So what's the policy here is trying to say what? Okay.
That should not allow to cheat, but I don't think student A is in the wrong because it doesn't specifically say in the policy that they need to read protect or read.
Right, okay, so two different things, right? So the policy kind of separates, so if you think about all possible states that this system could be in, right? The policy is what defines those states that are secure versus insecure. So in this case, secure means no students are copying from each other. So those are the secure states. So here we have a circumstance. The first question we want to ask is, has the system transitioned to an insecure state? I see some nodding. Why?
Because student B has copied the file.
Which directly contradicts our policy, right? So then going back to the original point, the question is, okay, so clearly, you know, and here we're using wrong kind of vaguely, but we know that student B transitioned the state of the system into an insecure state. Did student A do the same thing as well? So what do you think?
Yeah.
You think student A is in the wrong here?
Well, if that's how you define it, being wrong, if they transitioned it from secure to insecure, then yeah.
Student A, what do you think?
Well, if student A needs to read protect it, then it was insecure from the start, so he didn't do anything to transition it to an insecure state.
What do you think?
Well, I think student A put their homework on the server, right? And they're called permissions for a reason. You either grant or take away permission to do something. So by allowing other people to read your homework, you're giving them permission, like literally.
Interesting. Yeah.
Well, the policy isn't specific to the person that has the homework that's being copied. So it only affects just the person copying it.
Any other thoughts? Yeah.
I mean, my mind keeps coming back. I've been going over this the past two lectures now. Is the policy is against essentially theft. So, like, if I leave my wallet on the table and someone takes it, and you're going to punish me because I left the wallet. Like, the policy is saying don't be a thief. I mean, was I stupid to leave my wallet and leave the classroom? Yes. But what's the policy about? It's about theft and someone stole it. So it's not my fault someone chose to be a thief. And that's the imagery that comes to mind.
Interesting. Yeah.
You can still have a secure state
agree that the original policy itself needs to be readdressed. Like, after finding this flaw in it, perhaps the university would say, okay, this, you know, there's been a lot of ambiguity in our system, so not only can, you know, you not copy, but students are also responsible to make sure that their files are read protected.
Yeah, so we're definitely struggling with a lot of issues here, right? And this is what kind of it's difficult to reason about. So I think looking at it very strictly based on what it says, so the last person who spoke talked about basically, so a student making their file be readable by everyone, that does not violate the security policy, right? The system is in a secure state at that point. It's student B who chooses to copy that file that transitions the system now to an insecure state because a student has copied another student's work. That would be a very, I think that would be the way I would look at this problem. Then the question goes to, what do we do after this, right? As we, are we, if we are in charge of academic integrity violations and we see this, maybe we think, hey, we should modify the policy to say that you also shouldn't leave your wallet out, right? That it's up to the students to make sure they're safeguarding their files. The question is, though, what happens if if student B sends student A a phishing attack where they pretend to be Professor P and say, hey, I want to check your homework before it's submitted, send me your homework. In that case, is student A in the wrong because they fell victim to that? Because by our new policy that says if you share, right, then you are in the wrong. Got a hand in the mic? No? I assume that when you look like this, that's not you. Yeah?
Maybe it should be if you knowingly share or use like well-established things like GitHub or something to openly share your own.
Right, so that gets into other weird issues where let's say we bring in a third party that you say, well, hey, I didn't share my, you know, I didn't make my code readable by everyone. I just posted it on GitHub and I didn't know that it's public by default that anyone could see it and pull down the copy of the code. Right, so does that let student A off the hook now to say they didn't violate the policy?
I think it's difficult to make the policy black and white. There's definitely shades of gray here, shades of reasonableness that the user that should or should not do to protect that information. So it's kind of hard to pick out every situation necessarily. They're always going to have edge cases.
Right.
Yeah, I think the goal is just to make policy as specific as possible to handle the events. Like, I know some places have sent an email that says we'll never ask for like
Yeah, definitely. So I think that's a great point. So talking about the policy, and maybe we know that we can't write a policy that can state unambiguously whether things are secure or insecure, but this also kind of points to that we should try to be creating and enforcing mechanisms that closely enforce our policy. Right. So in this case, if we wanted to allow that, we could put mechanisms in place to say that users cannot change their home directory to be, let's say, world readable. Right? That could be a mechanism that we put in place to ensure that a student can't inadvertently. But as we just said, that causes problems with now when we want to actually collaborate on a project. Yeah?
I'm just kind of thinking like, for instance, like, let's say, legally speaking, like, so other countries don't have ticketing. So people that come from other countries come to the US, they see free money on the table. They just say, let's go ahead and do that. That's still theft, but they didn't know that that was actually meant there for the person, the waiter or waitress.
If some foreigner said they didn't know what tipping was, they were probably lying to you.
So, okay, so yeah, so then it kind of goes into, well, as part of the policy, how do you make your users aware of the policy?
By making them sign an agreement.
By making them sign an agreement, exactly. Or, so in every single syllabus, there should be something about academic integrity violations and a pointer to the ASU code of conduct that specifies everything there, right? So that's part of the university trying to enforce and say that, hey, this is not a defense that you didn't know, right? So everyone has to play by those same rules. Cool, any other thoughts on this example? This is good. So what about the, so going back to the wallet example, So is this the same situation here where student A has just left their wallet out on the table and it's the person who actually takes that is in the wrong? I like that idea. Left your house, your front door unlocked and wide open, right? So does that mean that somebody can, then if they rob you, it's on you and it's your fault because you left your front door unlocked and open? Yes? No?
I guess technically you don't have a duty to protect your wallet, whereas in this case, by creating the policy, we created this duty to kind of protect your home.
But we didn't. We didn't say that in the policy.
If the policy had something, I mean, we went on and described a more succinct policy. But no, in this case, I still think there would be less violation.
Interesting. Yeah.
Well, the other thing, too, is the process of punishment, too. Like, for instance, usually the way it works, the first time that you're caught like that, you're suspected to be caught with it, get a zero on the assignment, and you get reported to the dean's office, and the dean's office then deals with you. And if you get caught again, you can actually see in the court. So there's a process of punishment. That process of measures that occur there. So we had someone has to arbitrate whether it was actually occurring there or not.
And we have places, things in place. There's an appeals process that you can go to where your case will be heard by independent folks who can kind of make a decision whether they believe you violated the actual integrity policy. So yeah, you can't really definitely do this black and white thing. To go back to the house example, so I would say that, yeah, you wouldn't be necessarily, it's not your fault that somebody broke into your house because you left the front door unlocked. However, let's say your homeowner's insurance, they may want to increase your premiums after they find out that's why, because you were lax about enforcing your own mechanisms to keep your house safe, right? So you could have other repercussions in there. Cool. So what this kind of brings us to is what we're talking about here in this in this topic is authorization. So what does authorization mean? We've actually been using it up until this point, right? What does it actually mean? Or what are some ideas of what it encompasses?
Yeah. I think it has to do kind of with, like, is a user able to do what, like, a certain task, but not necessarily, like, you kind of already assume they are who they say they are. Mm. So is this person who they say they are they able to then do the thing?
So what do you guys think? Does that agree, disagree? Yeah.
That's authentication. So authorization is going to be what you have access to.
So what's the difference?
So authentication is, are you who you say you are, and then authorization is, what are you allowed to act?
Everybody agree? Anybody disagree? Or want to add something? You don't have to disagree. Yeah.
I guess I just don't like the word able to access. I think authorization is something that comes from an authority. So somebody that can, can say, I allow or disallow this action.
So similar to our previous example, right? So just because student B could access that file doesn't mean they should, according to the policy. So they're still not authorized to read that file by the policy, even if the mechanism allowed them to do so. That's a great point. Anything else? Okay. Yeah. Yeah, so I kind of think of it as, well, now I'm maybe going to change this to reflect this discussion. So what authorization tries to answer the question of what can you do on the system, or what should you do on the system based on what the policy says you should be able to do, right? So I see it as coming directly from the policy states what you should be allowed to do, and this is the authorization is what we use to talk about of what should you be allowed to do on the system. And so there's two interesting points here that brought up that we were just talking about with authentication, is how do we define you, and how do we tie you to an actual individual or person, right? And in different contexts, we may have different ways of doing this. So authentication, we're going to cover that in a later module, later section. And so authentication kind of tries to answer the question of who are you, right? So at this point, let's assume that we've solved the authentication problem. We know who this person is. So we're only going to think about what can that person do on the system. So what types of attacks and threats, because we're not considering authentication, do we not have to worry about anymore? Spoofing, or is that? Yeah, so what kind of spoofing? Do you want to elaborate?
I don't know, just like pretending that you're somebody else.
Yeah, so we don't really have to worry about somebody pretending to be somebody else. What else?
Are we not worried about authentication as a whole? So do we not care about phishing, or do we care about that other people are who they say they are?
Tricky. I'd say let's not consider that. So authentication actually goes both ways, right? Because we need to know who we are, and what's the other thing we want to authenticate? Is the system actually the system I'm supposed to be talking to, right? And that actually gets into the phishing problem, where we're the correct person, but we're trying to authenticate to a system that is not the original system. Exactly, that's good. So we'll bucket that under authentication problems. Any other threats that become more interesting, less interesting? Spoofing, pretending to be somebody else. So it all kind of ties back into what we were talking about. We want to define precisely the authorization scheme that we have so that we can understand who in the system we have to trust. So this way, we can explicitly state the authorization of the, as we'll see, the users on our systems against all of the, let's say, assets, or we'll use objects in a second. And this allows us to analyze the system to say, okay, who do we trust? Do we have super users on the system, or super administrators who can access everything? Then we know we either need to trust them, or we need to make sure that we can audit and keep track of everything they're doing on the system in case they ever do anything wrong. And the whole idea is about managing risk. So we talked about risk and risk analysis a lot, right? So how does defining what people can do on our system, how does that help us manage risk? Yeah.
Well, if you know what they can do, you can know what kind of damage they can cause, and you can measure like how much risk will be associated with what they can do.
Exactly. So if I know that, let's say, I have a website and I have roles for administrators on the system, regular users, and guest users, right? And if I can define the authorization so that I know that guest users can't have a very limited impact on the system, then I can start to reason about, okay, yes, guest users can only do these things on the system, therefore I've mitigated the risk of some guest user causing havoc. right? But now I want to ask the question, are my regular users, do they, are my regular users potentially at risk? So what could a regular user do that I need to think through, that have I actually limited and restricted them as much as possible? What about just saying they can't do anything? Just revoke all, everything they can do on the system. Does that make it secure? Pretty secure. What does it do?
They can't do anything.
Yeah, they can't do anything, so you don't have a system, right? So you need, essentially, the idea is, and we'll kind of touch on this in a lot of points, is that there's this, you want to give, essentially, when it goes back to what can they do, we want to let them be able to do everything they need to do in order to function properly in the system, but no more. So this is called the least privilege principle. So we want to restrict what they can do to just what is essential to actually function in the system. Why is that a good idea? Yeah?
It'll help prevent accidental mistakes as well.
Yeah, so this helps. So if we have a strong authorization mechanism that we know that the users can't bypass, now this greatly restricts what they can do. So if another problem occurs, we know that the damage that maybe if, let's say, a guest user somehow is able to convince the system that they're a regular user, we've actually limited and restricted what that regular user can do. So we've limited the impact of any attacks. And this goes back again to the idea of risks and minimizing risks. Part of this is, how many people use Android phones? Not a lot of people. iPhones? No. Almost as much. How many people are there in here? Windows phones? Oh, one person. All right, good. Good for you. Awesome. So when you download, let's say, a flashlight app, what permissions would a flashlight app need to do its job?
Contacts, data storage.
Now, what do they usually ask for? What does it actually need to do its job? Yeah.
The camera.
It would need maybe access to the camera, but it depends. We may, so if we think about ourselves unconstrained in the current operating systems, maybe just access to the light on the camera, right? Because so what happens if we give, let's say, this flashlight app access to our camera? What can it get?
Pictures of us and spy on you.
Yeah, if you get any kind of pictures, it can see what you're pointing at while it's running. It can maybe use the front-facing camera if there's no way to distinguish between that. It can record you, record what you're doing, to maybe try to build up a profile of you to sell you better ads or something. Right? So ideally, we should just say that, hey, this app should only be using the flashlight. But, so what permissions do a lot of apps want? So somebody said contacts. What else?
Current location.
Current location. What else? You think that's super important to a flashlight app?
Absolutely.
Yeah, so we're gonna adjust the brightness of the light depending on where you are and the time of day or something. Yeah.
Files or file history.
Is that files or file history?
Yeah.
Yeah. Good. What else? What are you saying? Yeah.
Payment information.
Payment information. If you want your credit card information.
Notifications.
Notifications. If you want to pop up notifications to remind you to use the flashlight.
Can't see.
Right.
What version you have? What version is compatible?
Yeah. So if they ask for information about your Android version and what version you're running. So all of these kind of go to show, and this is, what I'm trying to do is get you to think about, we're talking about authorization at kind of a high level on a systems basis, but really this comes into play in your everyday usage of your devices and your phones, and you are making that decision whenever you install an app, man, is what I'm giving this app actually what it needs in order for it to do its job? And oftentimes, and I completely understand, because oftentimes I'll just install it because it's easier to use it than to not use it. And, you know, whatever, it has access to your contact list and everything else, and you just kind of don't really think about that, but when you think about it, you've given that app more authorization than it needs to actually do its job. Does anybody run any of the crazy mods that allow you to control like those fine-grained privacy settings on like a per app basis and like feed them false information? No? I can't remember which Android versions those are, but yeah, there's some work that people did on research work to basically lie to the apps and say, yes, they can have my location data, but it's going to be fake location data. And they can have my contact list, but it's going to be a fake contact list. And so basically, because you as the user know that they're not actually going to use that for any good purposes, so or functionality of the app. Yeah.
I just want to point out that there's a lot of that business that goes on in EULAs, like when you sign up for a service, none of us ever read any of that crap.
So what's a EULA?
It's an end user license agreement.
Yeah, so that's
it gives
the thing.
Authorization or permission for a service provider to do these same kind of things with whatever the services we're using.
Correct. So they may claim in their end user license agreement that you have consented to give them this information and that maybe they need that, and maybe they will claim as to how they're going to restrict the usage of that data, but you as a consumer don't really have any alternative to either accept it or reject it, so. Good, so all these things come back with authorization. And the idea is managing risk, because can we ever completely eliminate risk? No. Why not? No is the easy part of that answer. Yeah?
Well, so you have a service and you want people to be able to do something. So in giving them information to do something, you're opening up the door for problems for whoever to be able to do whatever you're trying to let someone do.
Exactly. So I think about it this way. So let's imagine we have a perfect policy that perfectly defines the secure states and the insecure states. We have a fantastic mechanism that precisely enforces the policy. Have we still eliminated risk? Yes?
I think you can eliminate a risk, but not all risk. Sometimes when you're eliminating a risk, you might also create more risks.
Yeah, I would be careful about making equivocal statements that you can even completely eliminate a risk. It can be true for a very small limited section of a risk. For instance, like a classic example would be, let's say buffer overflow vulnerabilities we'll see are very prevalent in low level like C and C++ style languages. So you can actually completely eliminate this entire class of vulnerabilities by moving to something like Java or Python. But you're still at risk because there still could be buffer overflows in the JVM itself, which an attacker could exploit. And even more likely is attackers will move to other things like SQL injection that are still prevalent in Java applications too. So you can definitely, but see, yeah, that's the problem. So the problem is saying you completely eliminate something. That's a very strong statement.
And if you don't have your internet,
true.
Also causing other problems for yourself.
Yes, exactly. Availability problems, right? So, yeah, managing what the system's supposed to do.
You risk not being able to get back to the computer.
Yes. That's actually, yeah, risk with using a very, very strong password that you don't write down anywhere or store anywhere. Right? It's like you risk that you forget it, and so you just have to reset your password anyways, and so what's the point? So why else? Why can we not? So we maybe talked about we can maybe eliminate like a tiny risk or a very well-defined risk. Why can't we eliminate it even if we have a perfect policy with a precise mechanisms? Yeah.
There are risks you don't know about.
There are risks we don't know about. We want to elaborate.
There could be some kind of an exploit that nobody's aware of except for the attacker until they'll use that, so you can't really protect against something you don't know about.
Right. So these mechanisms are human created devices, right? They're not, they are not infallible. And so there could be there could be vulnerabilities inside the code of your mechanism itself that somebody has found a vulnerability in and can actually bypass your policy and your mechanisms that way. Yeah.
Also, technology is changing all the time, so it's possible that something new can come out that can
make an insanely precise and greatly secure policy in, let's say, the 1980s, which now if you continued that way up until now, and that policy didn't consider the fact that people have internet and that everyone has a device that has access to the internet, right? If you're not considering these kinds of things, then the circumstances surrounding the policy can shift over time, and so your policy may actually not be secure to the new threats. That's a great point. Yeah?
It might be a threat you can pull it into account more, like maybe when you, your hardware is being China, they put a circuit inside your computer, and it sends out a little transmission every 30 seconds about what you're doing.
Yeah, so I've, super interesting. So there's a paper, I don't remember the year, but basically they showed that into a Wi-Fi chip, you could inject a backdoor that would, Wi-Fi signals and whatever are all physical mediums, right? So the wave that's traveling through the air. And I'm not a physicist or an electrical engineer, so that's about my knowledge of it. But there's defined thresholds into what counts for what. There's variations in there in what can physically happen versus what the device will read it as. So what they did is they inserted a backdoor into this Wi-Fi chipset, so the actual chipset on your device, such that when you connect it to a private and password encrypted Wi-Fi, it would actually be encoding the password into those little noise, into the noise distribution, such that it didn't change the signal, but if somebody knew, let's say, the secret key, they could decode that to read and figure out what the Wi-Fi password is. So yeah, if your threat model includes nation states who tamper with your, or who could tamper with your hardware, you have to really be worried about you buying. It used to be that the military would make their own chips and fab all their stuff so they could actually secure that. What's the problem with that?
It's expensive.
It's really expensive, right? Especially when you talk about hardware, because you don't get the economy of scale that somebody like Intel or AMD or Motorola are getting by making hundreds, thousands, millions of these chips. So the government switched to buying what they call common off-the-shelf devices. But now then they have the problem of how can they actually be certain? So even if, let's say, the company who designed the chip gave them the design file, they're able to verify that there's no hidden backdoors, which in itself is a difficult problem. How can they actually be sure that that's what gets synthesized and actually made into the chip? That somebody at the manufacturing plant didn't insert some backdoor logic. Hard. It's a very hard problem. This is kind of the state of the art that of these hardware-based issues that people are worried about. And then there's even, there's all kinds of, not even necessarily backdoors, but undocumented features of hardware chips that could maybe allow debug access, all this kind of stuff. So, yeah, so even if, and this is kind of what it goes back to, is even if you could control everything, right? I mean, all the way to silicone, all the way up, it's still humans implementing these things, and so they can still introduce bugs and problems into the system. So to me, this is all a great discussion on why you can't eliminate risk 100%. But that doesn't mean we shouldn't try. Cool. So, authorization versus access control. So we'll try to be precise when we use these terms in this class, but they're often used a little bit interchangeably. So we kind of define what authorization is. So what is access control and how does it relate? Yes. This kind of relates to what we've been talking about for a long time, right? So essentially, I think of it as authorization is the policy, right? So it states who should be able to do what on the system to what objects. Whereas access control is the actual mechanism that enforces this authorization policy. So that's where we get into issues of permissions on files, as we're gonna get kind of all into that, all the different ways to think about this stuff. So just important, like I wanted to make sure we define this so we were able to keep in our heads authorization versus access control. Okay, so what we're gonna do now is we're going to look at different ways of how we can think about authorization and model, well, see, I'm gonna use them both, modeling our authorization policy and modeling our access control mechanisms so that we can kind of reason about the system and what can happen on the system. So we're gonna use three main classes of objects in our system that we're gonna think about. Our subjects, which we're gonna use as the set S. So subjects would be what? Administrators could be subjects, yeah.
A host?
A host? Maybe. It's tricky. I shouldn't have had the things here. Okay, so we're going to have subjects, we're gonna have, as we'll see in a second, we're gonna have rights. So we're gonna have the rights that subjects can have, and those rights may depend on the system itself. So on a file system, we're mainly concerned with read, write, execute, and maybe ownership, and possibly append. So we have subjects, rights, and we have objects. So subjects, we think about, these are things, what I think about in the system that can act, right? So this would be the users, it could be, let's see, this is why hosts doesn't really fit unless change the way we're thinking about our systems. Whereas objects, so objects are assets, all the assets and objects in the system that can be essentially acted upon. So the difference here is a file doesn't really act by itself. Is that true? What about an executable file? Doesn't that do stuff? What's the difference?
One is a file code, and one is just text.
What was that, Xavier?
So you have this idea of a program or a string in a file, and it's inanimate. It doesn't do anything. It's just a storage location for information. And then you have a program or a compiler that will take in that string and begin executing it. It spins up a thread or a process. And so you have this other dynamic runtime entity that's doing things and acting and making changes to the system.
Correct. Yeah, so that's definitely the way I think about it, is files are objects on the system. Even an executable file is just bytes on the hard disk. It's when a user wants to execute a file that the operating system will look at that file, analyze it, turn it into a running process, and when it's in a process, now it has its own rights and capabilities, so it actually becomes a subject at that point, where it can now act upon the system by trying to read files and write files and do everything that a user can do. Great. Cool. And then we have our rights. So we have, what can the subjects do to the objects? So why is it important to model this? Because everyone has to? Makes it easier to understand. Understand what?
What we're actually trying to accomplish.
Yeah. So, like, who's trying to accomplish?
People who are writing policies or that.
Right. So people are writing authorization policies. So this helps us to reason about the system, right? If we can look at this, if we can define this formally, and we can define a model of an access control system, then that can help us think about and analyze a system to answer the question, hey, is it possible for the subjects in the system to transition the system to an insecure state? Right. So the classic model of the access control model, this is going to model all of the access access for all the subjects on all of the objects in our system. So we're gonna have subjects on the rows, and the columns will be the objects in our system. And in each cell of this each cell in the matrix will have the rights that that subject has to those objects. So here we have subjects U and V, and remember this is very general, right? So subjects U and V, it doesn't matter what they are at this point, and we say we have objects F and G, and so that subject U has rights R1 and R2 on object F. Is this true?
Say what?
Are the...
Yeah, what true?
Exactly. That's a good question. So, we have subjects for each of the rows, right? And then each of the columns are what? Objects. What is U? What was that?
M is a subject.
U is a subject, so why is it a column?
Why is it a row?
It's a row, but it's also a column.
So I guess they can ask this, it's an executable maybe, or a process?
Yeah, so the idea is subjects can have rights to other subjects, right? And the key is what these things mean depend on the system, right? So whatever R4 is what U can have rights for itself. Similarly, apparently V does not have any rights to itself, so I don't know. Whatever that means depends on the system, so maybe. And you can actually have that in some systems. You can have, let's say, a process not be able to read its own memory, or you can have, you can kind of create interesting access control policies. They may or may not make sense depending on the system itself. So if these are the only objects and subjects in our system, what can we say about it? So if we look and then we can instantiate this model in different types of scenarios. So for instance, in Unix, usually we think about the subjects being processes. So why don't we think about the subjects as users? Like users log onto the system.
Processes are essentially the means with which a user interacts with the system, right? Like, you can't really model it. You couldn't throw me in there specifically, right? Like when I'm interacting with
Tron's
the computer, there. Like I'm telling some process to do something. That process takes out the.
So we think technically. So what when you log on so remotely, you SSH into a server, what happens? Starts a bash session. How does the system know to start bash and not ZSH or some other shell?
Configuration.
What configuration?
The one that's stored on the server.
Yes, which one specifically?
Bash.
right, so it's that, I don't have a Linux machine up, but it's the etc password PASSWD file has all the user accounts in the system, all of their user IDs, and one of the fields, so it is essentially a configuration file, one of the fields there is the shell that you want to be executed when you SSH into the machine. So it's your default shell. You can use the command chsh to change your shell to something else. And so the system knows when you correctly, so first you have to authenticate to the system, right? So you have to prove that you are that user account on the system. Either, as we'll see, passwords, private key. This is why I want to do crypto first before we go into authorization. So we can understand these concepts. When we finally authorize ourselves and it says, okay, yes, you are user A on this system, and here's which shell it's going to run. So now all of the input that you're sending gets passed to Bash, and all the output of Bash gets sent back to you. So it is just a process, right? You are not a concept to that computer. All you are is an authorization. When it's authorized you, Bash starts executing as a process with your user and group permission. So you'd be Bash, and it'd be essentially your user ID and your group ID on that process. And then when you type in something like ls, what does Bash do?
As it's executing, it checks each of the actions that ls takes against what it's allowed to take based on your user ID and your group policy ID.
Almost. What is it?
So the
in that statement. The kernel, okay, so
is executing the
take a step back. So how does Bash start executing ls? How does it know what to execute?
The input it receives?
Another configuration file.
Mm-hmm.
It invokes a binary, it makes a system call, it does something else.
So you think about it, your SSH into a machine, you type ls, you hit enter. So Bash sees that you input ls and then a new line.
I think I'm probably wrong, but
it's okay.
Wrong. When you hit ls, you point to a file that has an executable.
Yeah, so it first has to look through your path to find out is there an executable called ls. So that's the $path environment variable. It will look in all those folders. When it finds the first one it finds with an executable program called ls, which would probably be /bin, I don't know exactly where ls is. So then it will call exec to the operating system, exec/bin/ls, and you didn't pass it any arguments, so it won't put any arguments into its call to exec, I think it's execve, which will cause the operating system to then read in the bin ls, create a new process with the rights inherited from the person who created it, or the process that created it, which is Bash, and so the ls starts running with the permissions inherited from Bash. So, cool. So this is all to say that everything's a process. So users don't matter, right? I mean, people don't matter. All that matters is a process. So process is P and Q. We have files F and G. And we have different writes. Read, write, execute, append, and own. So what are the, obviously, so read and write are pretty easy, right? As to what they actually mean. Yes, I get some head nods. We'll cover it. We can go over it. So what about execute? So what does execute allow us to do? Yeah?
Like run the file?
Yeah, so run the file. So we can actually, the OS will allow us to execute and create a process from this file, essentially. What about append? What's the difference between append, read, and write?
Log files. You don't necessarily want the user to be able to read them or delete them, but they need to be able to add stuff to them.
So they can add to them without deleting anything that's been before. So can you have, just like you said, can you have append access to a file but not read access or write access? Yeah, sure, and that's what you may want, right? You may want a program that can only log to a log file but can't read from that log file necessarily. With one program, it's kind of silly because you wrote all of that log output, but let's say you want to consolidate a bunch of different programs into one log output, right? In in that case, you want all of them to be able to append to that file, but not to read from that file, because then they'd be leaking the information from the other process. What does own mean? Change the permissions of this file to add new rights to new users on the system. Cool. So we'll just use these RWXAO for right now. We'll talk about this simplified model. So now we can actually have kind of an instantiation. We can think about, okay, for our sake, simplicity, right? We want to use small numbers of subjects and objects. So here we just have two subjects and two objects. So then how can this matrix change and who changes it? Forces this access control call, this access control. Yeah.
So I don't know, but going back to the LS example, mm-hmm. I don't really understand how this works. You said that the LS process that was mm-hmm. spun up was given a copy of the permissions of the user that invoked it from the command line. And so as that is executing its binary and going through line by line and doing all of the weird file system, low level, inode, okay, here's this file. At that point in the LS application, is the logic embedded in there to check, okay, this file is supposed to be visible to this user, yes, no.
So
compare with the credentials I was given or the IDs that I were given. So is it in the logic of each application? Is it a system architecture and design and code pattern? So
what would be most effective? How would you design that? So you're kind of asking the question of where do you put the access control checks?
Well,
right.
If I was trying to use LS as a limited user and LS was the actual application restricting me from looking inside a particular directory,
mm-hmm.
I would probably write my own version of LS that didn't care, and that was just show me everything you could find.
Exactly.
So in my mind, embedding it in LS doesn't really work, so the check has to happen somewhere else.
Correct. So where would the place that you would put that? Somebody else? Yeah.
System, in the system libraries, so in the kernel, what we kind of think of as the kernel, when LS makes a function call to execute something in the kernel, then it checks whether there's authorization.
Right, so a good idea and a good way to think about access control mechanisms and where to enforce and do the access control checks. You want A to be in a central location, so you don't have to replicate those access control checks in every single application. Right? And you'd also want to make sure that it's some ways protected so that the users can't just change or modify or bypass those protections. So being in the kernel allows us to do this, because in order to open a file, any process on any Unix system, if they want to open a file, they have to call the open system call with the string of the file they want to open and any flags that they want to open the file with. Then the operating system will do its checks. And we can think of it for right now as it will consult this access control matrix to see, okay, does this process have this write on this file? And write with R, right, not W. Have this write to this file, and if they do, then open it, otherwise return an error message that tells them what happened. So types of systems, like web applications, is actually a huge problem because there is no central place to store these access control checks. They're literally littered throughout the application. So if you make some new API that doesn't use the main path of the application, you have to replicate all those access checks, which is a major source of problems on web apps. Cool. Okay, what was my original question here?
How does it change chmod?
So how does this matrix change over time? So what are different ways that it can change?
More users,
so we can add more processes to the system, right? So how could, let's say, So how could process P create a new process based on file F? Can process P just execute F?
No.
Why not?
Because you can't run code, you can't read. You have to be able to look at, you have to know what it is that you're running. You can't just like,
well, process P, so let's stop for a second. Can P read file F?
Yes.
Yes. Actually, can execute files that you can't read,
which is
silly, but yes, it depends on the system, so yes. But in essence, so process P can read file F, so can it execute it? How could it execute it? Yeah?
So the permissions it has on itself, could it modify its permissions on itself to be able to execute that?
On itself, on P?
Because if you look at the access control matrix,
yeah.
It owns itself, so that means it should be able to modify itself, right?
More like it.
What do you think? So I guess it comes down to the question of what does ownership over a process over a process, what does that mean? Right? Is that correct? So what does that mean? I don't actually know. So let's say that they can edit, what would make sense to me is that they can edit any of the permissions that P has on itself. So that would be part of ownership here. It means they could remove write access from themselves or execute access from themselves. Yeah?
I thought maybe he was talking about F. Since you own F, you could change the add execution permissions to F and then execute it.
Exactly. So process P owns file F, right? So they can, and based on the concept, so this is all, remember, about the specific system that we're talking about now. And we just defined that and ownership over an object means that you can control the permissions that you have to that object. And possibly, depending on how we do it, that may also control the permissions that other people have on that object. So in this case, I may be able to change P, may be able to change Q's rights over F. May be able to remove append access, make it executable. So if P wanted to execute F, they would issue to the system a chmod, which would call a system call to try to change to add the execute privilege to P to F, so the column would read RWXO, and then now P could execute F, and this would create some new process U in the graph, and going with our inheriting permissions would basically be a copy of all of P's permissions. Yeah.
I just want to say, I don't know who said it, but the guy over there, whoever it was, that said, if P is a compiler, maybe it doesn't have ownership over F in that case, but it can still read it. So if P can read F, append F to itself, as it has permission to do, and then re-execute itself with F included, it's a roundabout way to execute F. So whoever's idea that was to do that first, that was awesome. That's like,
I see. So the idea would be you could read, so even if you don't have to think about compiler, if just F is an executable file, if you can read it but you can't execute it, then maybe you can read F, copy it to a directory you control, make it executable because you now own that file, and then execute it. Yes, possibly, as we'll see when we complicate this model, it'll depend on the, you can pretty much always do that, but there are special ways you can get permissions to file F, for instance, that it executes as root or some other user. And so in that case, by copying that file, you lose those special privileges, so it would just execute as you, which may or may not be what you want. But yeah, that's a good way around that. Cool. So what are some of the benefits of using this access control matrix? What is this good for? Yeah.
Easy to understand what subjects have rights to which objects.
Yeah, so it's pretty easy to understand. If I asked you any question,
I don't know.
Can process Q write to file F? Arbitrary writes, no, but append write, yes. What else? What are some other benefits? Challenges of how do you visualize it when there's now a million files on the system, right? And being able to try to answer some of those questions. Yeah?
Sort of like writing out a grid for like a logical problem or something, it could help you see repercussions of certain permissions that may not be explicitly stated, but like it would follow from the permissions they already have.
Yes, so that's a great point. So the book goes into this much more. We won't go into it in class, but you can formally define each of these operations we said of changing ownership and you can change ownership on Unix, you can change permissions if you have owner access to that file. Also, you may be able to change all in this row if you own that file, so you can change everybody else's access. So then if we wanted to ask the question, if part of our security policy is it should never be the case that that Q, we want it to never be the case that Q can write to file G. Right? If that was our security policy, we would say, does this access control matrix actually enforce that policy? No, because even though in this current state of this matrix, Q cannot read or cannot write to file G, we can see that that file has ownership, that Q has ownership of file G, and so they can change the permissions to get write access to that file. So we can model it, and we can talk about transitions, and then we can make proofs that say, given if we start in this state, there's no way to transition this matrix to any state that violates the security policy. What are some other benefits? I'd say it's a pretty fast lookup, right? So if you're the operating system implementing this access control matrix, right? And you say, hey, I have process Q, it's trying to write to file G, do I allow that or not? Well, it's very easy, you just look up, right? It's an index lookup, you say, okay. What about drawbacks? What are some drawbacks to this? Yeah.
I assume that the matrix itself is too big to be stored in memory, which means it's going to have to be stored in a file, and you're going to have to protect that file.
Yes, so lots of problems here. So we do actually, in general, have the problem of how do we securely store the access control, the authorization policy here. And so that would definitely be, so size would definitely be a huge drawback here, because we have now this massive, and every time a new process executes, we have to add an entire new row here. Yeah?
You need a legend?
A what?
If you're going to be able to read, you need to know what those symbols mean. So you need a legend somewhere so you can actually figure out what it is.
Right, so we also, so it's a great theoretical model because we can have these ideas of read, write, and execute. But what if I told you G was a directory? Then what does writing to a directory mean? What about reading from a directory? What about execute on a directory? Right, so we want to have, in order to evaluate our security policy against this formal model and this matrix model, we need actually all of these rights formally defined as well, which is can be difficult, especially in a real system. Yeah, so let's say, that's a good point. So let's say that, so we said these are all process, right? These are all processes on the subjects. So let's say I have five of these processes that are running for me. Now, I changed one of the files to give my user access to this file, read access to this file. Now, the operating system to update this access control matrix would have to update every row with every process that had my permissions, right? Because essentially all the processes on the system have the same rights as the user account that is running them, maybe modulo. So there could actually be performance issues or problems or things to consider and think about is how to actually update this matrix. It may not be as simple as just change one cell. We may have to change all cells such that some other thing is true. What else about this matrix? So drawbacks. Yeah.
How would you check for correctness?
Checking for correctness? That is a difficult question. Yeah, so that also would be difficult to reason about because every single file in the system could have its own unique kind of access here with all the different processes in the system. So the way I view it is these are a great way to think about access control in this form of this matrix because it's very precise. It defines exactly everyone what they can do on the system, all the objects. The big drawback, though, is simply size, right? So every time a new file is added, you have to add a new column in this matrix, and it would just get huge over time, and then with all the subjects, and so you have a very sparse matrix, and you have problems with how to store that, and it gets to be a nightmare. So it may not be a surprise, but almost nobody actually implements these access control matrix like this. So the idea is to kind of split up the storage and to split up the way that we think about this. So what would be some options? Yeah.
Start generalizing big chunks of columns and rows together into classes and say that all of these files are in this particular class and anything in this class will just do the same. We just abstract it and kind of start blobbing things together to press the matrix down.
So we could create some kind of hierarchy that said, so we'd maybe go back to our student homework example. We may be able to classify, let's say, a bunch of files as homework files, right? So maybe we can try to give some policy of how those homework files can be read or write by users. Maybe we can do some kind of hierarchy to cluster and to collapse essentially some of these columns so that multiple objects are all underneath one category. Sure, what else? So you want to access your process, so you're the operating system, right? You're the access control mechanism. You're seeing that the user wants to access file F. What do you actually need to know from this matrix in order to make that determination?
Do they have read access?
Do they have read access? Well, what in this matrix do you actually need? Do you care about the access to files G, process P and the process Q? No, what do you care about?
Cell PF.
care about the cell PF, exactly. So all you care about is this cell. So one way to think about it is maybe for every object in the system, you just store the column here. And so that's essentially access control list, where you say, okay, for file F, we're gonna store on file F, and again, this goes to how do you store it, how do you make sure that it's that a regular user can't tamper with it, but essentially, you store with file F, okay, process P has read, own, and read, write, and own, while process Q has append access, right? And now the operating system, whenever you wanna access this file F, it will look up this metadata, this access control list, and say, okay, so I know this is list, these are all the users that have writes on this object, so I'm gonna look up what writes does P have. Okay, great, P has read access, then they can get access to this file. And so similar thing, so I kind of visually tried to say that these are distinct now pieces of data. Essentially, so each column of the matrix is stored with the object. So what's the benefit here, and what's the drawback? Good things? Or some drawbacks?
Yeah,
store the
metadata somewhere.
What was that?
Yeah, store the metadata somewhere so the file can be
here. Yeah, you definitely have to store the metadata somewhere, but you know, we're the file system, so we have, we're the operating system, so we have complete control and we mediate all access essentially to the file system, so we can make sure those are secure. Exactly. So accessing maybe a specific file F, right? We don't really, we don't have to store any of the other processes that have no writes on this file. So we can deal with the sparseness there. And we don't have to load this entire matrix to figure out exactly F and Q. We actually know exactly which file we're interested in because that's the file we're trying to access. So a drawback here would be changing essentially one process's writes to all the files would mean changing every single file in the file system. Right? So it would mean, because this matrix does not exist in one centralized location, so you can't just say, okay, great, I'm gonna change this row. So it's, you gotta think about how you're storing things, right? If you're storing things column-based, now this means doing a row operation means that you have to go access every single file in the system. Yeah.
Isn't that solved mostly by the fact that our processes are kind of structured as a hierarchy and our files are structured as a hierarchy? So when we chmod a file, and we can recursively make the changes to the files within that file?
You can, so chmod has a dash capital R option that will recursively make those changes, but by default it does not do that. So it only changes that file itself. And this is part of the problem, is this is how most systems are implemented, so we've been thinking about access control in these terms for a long time. You chmod the file, right? You don't say, I want to take away process P's read access to all files, right? You don't think that way because it's hard to actually do with the system, even though you can do that, and maybe you just delete that user, and that's how you get rid of that. But it's a thing that actually makes an operation more difficult, which you may want to do. Great. All right. Let's stop here on Thursday.
Oh, okay.